Hello, Daniel Spisak speaking. Hope you're fine. It's a big pleasure to be with you today. And I will try to disclose some new Katia jewels in these nine episodes of the series. So today, the focus of today is to really show you what we can do in terms of assembly design in 3D experience Katia. For those who will ask me the question, I'm sure what everything I will show you today is on 3D Experience CATIA. It will be a mix of 21X, which is the current release available, and some older release of 3D Experience CATIA, but not that old 20X or 19X. So I'll start. So the very first important new capability of assembly design compared, for example, to CATIA V5, is what we call engineering connection. Engineering connection is the equivalent in V5 of the assembly constraints. But you will see that it's much more powerful. That's one benefit, but it is also much more easy to use. Let's have a look. So, for example, I will just disassemble very quickly, very freely, this assemble of which is on the screen. So those are the two parts. And now let's have a look how we will create the constraints of those parts. So here I just have to check coincidence, and automatically CATIA find the axis of the first hole and will align those two axes. Okay, so it's an axis to axis coincidence. Now I will just put now in position and say this is in contact, those two surfaces are in contact, two faces, and that's it. Okay. Now, if I want to do the same, I will just fix this component inside the assembly, and I will now align the other part with this fixed part. And then I have to also define the position in Z, and I just select the two faces that have to match to position perfectly the part. At the end, you will see that on the screen here, on the spec tree, you have one cylindrical engineering connection, some planar, some fixed, and a revolute revolute engineering connection. Okay, so it's very easy, very visual. You know, no big dialog box, very easy to use. Okay, that's the first thing, engineering connection. Now let's move to another topic. Remember, in my previous CATIA talk, I was talking about some new UI of part design or generative shape design. But here, this is already an assembly, but I already create all my connection. And now let's have a look at the benefit of having those engineering connection. So this is my assembly. You see here all the list of engineering connection between all those parts. Some rigid, some fixed, some cylindrical, some symmetry, whatever. And now what I will just have to do is to define one command, which one input if you prefer. So let's select one of them. This cylindrical engineering connection will be driving the mechanism. And I just have to say, okay, let's play the mechanism with this command. And now you can easily, so you are not forced to go to another application to define the kinematic joints. Okay, everything is done in one shot, and you get the kinematics for almost free. Just you have to define the input. Okay, that's quite nice capability of 3D Experience CATIA. We will talk in the next CATIA talk about the kinematics itself, because it's so good that I need a full CATIA jewel talk about kinematics. This will be done later on. So, of course, as you know, thanks to the nice rendering capability, real-time rendering capability of 3D Experience CATIA, you can also animate the mechanism in with this highly realistic view. Probably something you can do with your customer or the sales rep of your company with his customer. Okay? That's it. Now let's go to another nice capability of 3D Experience CATIA, which is the symmetry of assemblies. Okay, this is my assembly. I just navigate on the assembly, And I start to use this symmetry of assembly. Let's click on the part, and you will see that here I can move up and down from the final leaf, which is the one I picked, to all the branches up to the last parent of this component. So here you can move, you see, from one part to the next assembly, the next one, up to the root one, which is the one I just selected here. So I just want here to mirror this actual sub-assembly. So I have to select for sure the mirror plane. Here it is. Everything is dimmed except the sub-assembly I am working on. So there is a very nice display about what has been mirrored. And now, very nicely, you will define when the assembly is mirrored, what is kept as unchanged, if you prefer. So it will be the same reference here than on the other side. What is really mirrored, so it's really a new part because it's really the mirror of the first part. And what should be removed, for example, or maybe what should be replaced by something else which is in a catalog or in the database. So you just have to select the part and you select the status of this part. So this will be an original reference, it's a new part. You select, you can go from the part up to another level of assembly. So let's go to the second level here, these small boxes, this tank for the liquid for breaking. So this will be also, for example, you define the status of this one. Now I will select some other guys. I will make an origin, a new part if you prefer. I select here I can do a mirror inside the mirror if you prefer by just mirroring the part with another plane. Okay, here we go. It's a new part because this is really a symmetry of the opposite side. Okay. Let's go and select now the glass itself. Here we go. It will be obviously a new part because it has to be mirrored. It has to. Okay. And for this component, I will just replace it by something else which is in my database, in my catalog. And I select the part in the catalog. So let's use another one. This clutch master cylinder. And it is replaced. So as you can see, you go very quickly from a complete assembly to define if it's new references, if you are just creating an instance of an existing part, so you are not duplicating the part within the database. Here we go. And you can see that we have replaced the actual component. And we have removed this guy because this was not to be mirrored. In the spec tree, you can see all the various components, the reference which have been kept, the new references which have been added. Okay. By the way, this is the first way of using assembly mirror, which is, let's say, manual. There is another way, more automatic, where you will ask Katia to find itself what has to be really mirrored and what is our new references. Okay. So it's exactly the same tool. You see here, there is some improvement in the UI. This is 21x. The previous version I showed you was 20x. So the UI is a little bit different. So you click on the assembly. You will see that the selector of the level is a little bit different. But still easy to use. You select the mirror plane. You display the mirrored assembly. You dim what is not necessary. And here you use auto detect reusable original references. So now there is some algorithm in Katia to find out which one will be original references. He found out those three green parts, but in fact, I do not want again to mirror the tank. So I will remove it from the mirror command. Here we go. I remove, no symmetry. And at the end, I have the same result as what I did some minutes ago, but much, much faster. And here I have the final mirror sub-assembly. So we talk about engineering connection. Let's see now how we can put in the right location very quickly a component. Okay. In fact, in CATIA there are multiple type of components, and I will go from the less intelligent to the very very smart at the end of the presentation. So let's start with the less intelligent. But you will see that it's quite easy to position, for example, a screw at those various locations of another assembly made of two parts. So I go to my catalog, and I will look for a screw. Okay, I have multiple type of screw. I will select this orange screw. Okay, and it comes, of course, in the middle of the space. And now I have to position the screw. It's not, as you can see, this cannot be done as a pattern. It's not a regular pattern or cylindric revolution pattern and so on. Even a user pattern, it's not really a pattern. You have multiple location. So I will just now do this engineering connection once. So let's go take the axis, or click on the cylinder, click on the hole. I do the alignment, then I put in position one face to another. So this one will be in contact with the other one. Here we go. And the screw is located. By the way, you saw that when I am doing this engineering connection between two parts, all the other parts are dimmed for you to be sure that you can see exactly what you have to do. In this case, there is only one on the left side. And now I will redo exactly the same. Sorry for the lag of the video. And the same positioning is automatically done with the screw for all the holes. So it's very, very fast, very efficient to position a component if you have multiple instances of the same component. Here we go. Let's continue. And the final one. Okay, that's the second nice capability of 3D Experience CATIA, thanks to those engineering connection and the multiple instantiation. Now I will move to a new capability to position parts themselves, which is called mechanical interfaces. But before that, I will show you how you can insert an existing component. It can be a subassembly, but it can be also an engineering template. So this is a particular machine that is filling bottles with a particular liquid. Let's see how we can start to work on this assembly. So I use here a new capability of 3D Experience CATIA called library. It's like a catalog, but with richer capabilities. So I select in my library not a standard component or a standard assembly, a template, an engineering template. So I take, it is called frame template, and I'm instantiating it. So the engineering template is at the level of assembly what a user-defined feature or a power copy is at the level of the part. Okay, so you can define all your input, the one which are proposed to the end user, and you can define also some major or main parameters that the user might change. And you have also a display of the part. So I have as input middle point, left point, right point. So you see here on the screen of the instantiation dialog box, the explanation of what is middle, what is left, and what is right. So you can follow the picture, which is in fact a 3D model. You can define parameters, for example, the frame length. This is the parameters we are exposing to the end user. And once you say OK, we are now from the template, creating the template at the right location with the right dimension. We can also, from the same catalog, not only do engineering template. An engineering template is something which is a dynamic model, OK? We can just also can instantiate standard components, OK? But remember, a component can be a sub-assembly itself. So I will here instantiate another type of component. It's not a template. It's a non-dynamic component. It's called a gripper unit. So when it is instantiated, of course, in this case, it will just arrive somewhere in the screen, in space, here you see on the right side. And I will use now what we call mechanical interface to position one assembly versus the other. So I will no longer use engineering connection, but this interface-based connection. In this interface-based connection, you have defined once what we call mechanical interfaces, and you can give a name, and then those mechanical interfaces are highlighted or are popping up on the screen for you to select what mechanical interface has to be connected to another mechanical interface. So the gripper interface on this part will be connected to the gripper interface on the receiving assembly, and it's positioned automatically. And at the end, you can use the same interface for all any other sub-assembly to quickly assemble your complete product, as it is shown here. Okay. Now, to finish, let's talk about what we call smart mechanical component. You have this particular component, and now you are adding some intelligence to the component. You have to do that only once. For example, this is my component, but this will be used to make a hole and maybe even a threaded hole into the receiving structure. So you are here in the define component dialog box or command. So you select the geometry which will be used just to either make a drill hole, make a tap hole, make a pad, make a pocket, which is in fact what will be removed with impact analysis or Boolean operation from the receiving structure. So I will say I would like to have a tap hole. Perfect. And now I will instantiate this particular smart mechanical component. And in the receiving structure, you can define what we call anchors. Okay. And those anchors are typed. The typing means that they can only receive some type of components, not all of them. Okay. So it's a very good way to prevent errors when you are combining multiple parts together. So you select the part, you select the component you would like to instantiate, which was just my foot component that I just typed a couple of minutes ago. Here we go. I will not create automatically the hole. You can create automatically the hole, the drillings, but I will not use that this selection for now. Automatically, as you can see, the parts are positioned at the right orientation, okay? And now I will say no impact, don't make the drillings first, and that's it. Now, if you want, you can do later on all the impact. So I have four components, so four impact here, which will create the hole. So now I can say, let's define my impact. So this is a table which is impacted by the 4 foot, which are in blue, and I update, and the holes and the drillings in the receiving structure are automatically created. Here we go. You could even imagine that, for example, you are 3D master. This hole has to be with a special accuracy, and maybe you will have put an H, you would like to have an H7 quality on this particular hole. So you can have, using functional tolerancing and annotation, you can have a small 3D tolerance that with a flag which is added to this hole, and then this hole will be flagged with the H7. Of course, if I change the dimension of my table, those smart mechanical component and the impact and the drillings are automatically updated. And if we want to see that in action on this particular jigs mechanism, so I have this sheet metal part, I have to instantiate some locating pin, quite complex, with different heights. So here we go, we create the holes. And now let's imagine there is a design change. So this is my version A, this is my version B on the right side. So the difference is here, okay? There is a step. You have nothing to do. The smart mechanical component will automatically self-adapt to the new design change. Here we go. So it allows a very, very robust design changing update, okay? And let's finish now by the same concept, smart mechanical component, but really pushed to a very, very high level of intelligence. This is still my machine to fill my bottles. And I will show you how we can instantiate some track roller. So you can see here the anchors that I have created. And I will just select a smart mechanical component from the library. For example, this filling unit, which is the one which is displayed here in the middle of the screen. And automatically, the filling unit is positioned at the right location with the right orientation without any other click than OK. And here, we have also the concept of adaptive smart mechanical components. Ooh, sorry for the lag. So I will select in the catalog my component. So the adaptive roller track. This is a template. This is a smart mechanical component. And now I create a new instance of my adaptive component. There we go. And automatically, he created the roller track at the right location. He automatically put as many pillars we need. So you can see that you can do very, very complex stuff with a smart mechanical component. And the good news is that this app, Katia Smart Mechanical Component, is inside every Katia, sorry, 3D experience Katia role, which is mechanical. So everyone, for example, moving from Katia V5 will automatically get this capability. Here we go. And you have even an extra bonus because with a smart mechanical component, you can make some small motion. So I will use the move component command. So I select my two components and the complete filler system, and I can start to move. Okay. And that's it for today. Many, many thanks for your attention. Our next episode will be also broadcast, in the Katia user community. I really recommend you to go to the Katia user community because first of all, you can replay and watch all the replays of the previous Katia talks. You can also get much more information about Katia. You can ask me questions and I can answer in this community. It's free of charge, of course. You just have to give an email address and type in a pass. And I wish you a very, very nice end of day or beginning of day. For sure, a nice coming weekend and talk to you soon. You will be again, I think in the 10 will be also surprised. Bye-bye.